Is it possible to just take an object, pick it up? This is a stone and a flower lying on top of it. But I've already interpreted it now through the mind. I've explained to you what it is. Is it possible to be some in your room and be in a relationship to objects that is non-conceptual, where you allow each object to be, each object that you perceive, so completely that you're not interpreting it or labeling it? So you pick something up, you feel it and you see it. It has a presence. And you let it be. And you're seeing it. Through stillness. At first, you might think, well, certainly the thinker thinks that this is not possible. You, as the thinker, thinks no. And besides, what's the point? I mean, I've got other things to worry about. It's hard to see, it seems such a simple and insignificant thing to do that. And to make that as part of your spiritual practice, and you could start with the world of objects, nature also, of course, but we relate to objects when we talk in terms of relationships. People think relationships to human beings. You relate even more to objects, because wherever you are relating to the world of objects, so-called inanimate. Not really inanimate, but so-called inanimate objects. You're always picking something up, you're sitting somewhere on something, handling something. It's the world of objects, and usually each object that you handle is a means to an end. You want to achieve something through it. Because in the mind-dominated state, each moment, or rather the one moment, is always reduced to a means to an end. Thereby you miss the fullness of life that can only be in the moment. And so, the reason, of course, why we are here is to allow a transformation of consciousness to happen so that we are no longer trapped in a conceptual reality, trapped in the conditioning of the mind. And we saw, we addressed that on our first day, how that is so closely related and actually the cause of even the great evils that we see. How does a terrorist become a terrorist? It is an extreme illustration, an extreme manifestation of being completely trapped in a conceptual reality where you reduce other human beings to mere concepts or labels in your head. And once you have reduced another human being to a concept or label in your head, you can do anything to them and you won't even know it anymore. You will feel nothing. You've cut yourself off, you've cut them off, you've cut yourself off from the deeper levels of your being. And you are totally mind-run, run by the mind, by the conceptual mind, by thought. And so, really, here we have the origins of what we could call evil. And that is, Jesus said, they know not what they do, forgive them, for they know not what they do. That process, in other words, is completely unconscious. It is the very essence of unconsciousness in the way that we use the term here, which means to be unaware of who you are beyond thought, of who anybody else is beyond thought. Complete lack of attention or awareness, totally trapped in conceptual thinking. And so, but everybody to some extent is trapped in that, not perhaps to such an extreme, but this is simply a terrorist or anybody else who perpetrates acts of violence, inflicts suffering on humans, has reduced those humans to a mental concept, and then you can do anything. But that is a very common, it's a normal way of being, really. It's just more extreme. And when you see it in an extreme form, you can recognize the madness of it more clearly. And people do it to themselves. They reduce themselves to concepts in the head through self-images and opinions about yourself, which you partly received since childhood from parents. Beliefs, concepts, opinions, this is what you are, this is how you are. And then you have a conceptual sense of self. And again, very limiting. And the conceptual sense of self is never at ease with itself. It's never enough because it's a fabrication of the mind. So it is so, to step out of that is the transformation of consciousness and realize what depth there is to you as a human being beyond conceptual thought. That, and actually realize that true intelligence lives beyond conceptual thought. Conceptual thought comes out of true intelligence, is one of many possible manifestations of it. But when you're trapped in this one little manifestation of intelligence, then your life is reduced to very little, a very limited entity, problematic entity. And then you inflict suffering on yourself through conceptual thought. You begin to have dialogues with yourself and telling yourself something, what, who you are, and not enough. So to gradually become free of being dominated by conceptual thought, continuous labeling and interpreting and judging. That's why to pick something up is such a powerful spiritual practice. It seems so insignificant, and the mind might tell you that you have better things to do than pick something up and look at it. At first, it may not be, thought may still be there. And then perhaps there's a moment when there's just looking. Just the awareness, the perception. Very different, qualitative difference in that perception from a conceptualized, from a perception reduced by conceptualization. And then you sense that even a stone has an aliveness to it, which nothing is alive when it's seen through mental concepts. Then the stone is more alive to you than another human being is to a terrorist, to take that as an extreme example. So that is a beautiful practice. It's a gentle way. See if you can relate to objects in that way. This strange thing happened to me many, many years ago when, after a night of suffering, intense suffering, a shift in consciousness happened. And the suffering conceptual entity, me, dissolved. And then I woke up the next morning and I looked around the room, and the first thing, I saw these objects, old, they were all familiar. I had never given them much attention because each object in my room was a means to an end. And then I picked something up, a pen. Oh. A few other little things. They're so alive. And there's presence, there's beingness there. I didn't know what that all meant. It was just a surprise, an astonishment of how alive the world actually is. I was astonished at the aliveness of it all, but I didn't know why I was astonished. I didn't know that my mind wasn't commenting anymore. Because otherwise the mind would have said, oh, you see, you're not commenting anymore. And that could happen to you. When you do, this shift happened to me by accident, one could say, and here it happens, one could almost say, by choice. In you, you have the choice to step out of that conceptual reality. At first you may not succeed. You may pick something up and immediately think about, oh, I mustn't think about this. Or there is a moment of simple awareness of that perception, and then immediately the mind says, now you've got it, that's it, you're right. And then, of course, the mind will say something, okay, now, okay, you've done that, now what's the next thing? As somebody said to me once, you always talk about the present moment. I mean, that's, we've heard it now, that's an old hat, present moment is... One writer in a newspaper who came to a talk said two things. One thing he said in his article, of course there's nothing new about the present moment. Teachers have spoken about it for thousands of years. But I must add, to his credit, in the next sentence he said, there's nothing new to the present moment and everything new to the present moment. Because the mind is looking for the next thing, always. Whenever you become impatient with the present moment, the mind is looking for the next moment. So, okay, you've got that. Understood, yes, present moment is all there is. Okay, we know that now. What's next? I have mastered the present moment. Certificate on the wall, master of now. So it's not an achievement. the transformation of consciousness is an achievement, or anybody who could say, now I have achieved it. It's a continuous, it's continuously new. So I recommend that every day, once or twice, you walk around your familiar room for a few minutes, and whatever you happen to look at, stay with it for a little while, a few moments or one moment. There aren't few, language is strange. I sometimes use that expression, a few moments. It doesn't exist. There's only one moment. It's just a way of speaking. And stay with that and see if you can let it be so completely that thought around it doesn't arise. If it arises, okay, then you know thought is arising. Okay, you're not fighting it, that produces more thought. Thought is arising, okay, and then you watch the thought. You're not trying to do anything. This is the, you could fall into the trap of trying to be thoughtless about it, free of thought. And in fact, it's the non-trying always means you need to get to some point in the future. It could be the point where you are free of thought. But the state of thoughtless awareness is already arising in you anyway, so you don't need to try. Just be gentle and allow it to be there. And so there's an alertness and a stillness through which you perceive. And now you perceive actually much more deeply. There is a depth to whatever you perceive that before wasn't there at all. Even so-called inanimate objects suddenly have a presence, a beingness, a certain aliveness. And imagine that depth that is already there, even with so-called inanimate objects, when they are perceived through stillness and non-conceptualization, what depth there is to natural things, the world of nature, how suddenly that deepens. And how you deepen, you discover how deep you are. That stillness is very deep. Whereas before, you were a shallow, nothing personal in that, it's a mind, a shallow being, because mental conceptualization, no matter how complex your mind is and how much you know and can talk about and think about, it's always shallow. It always moves on the surface of things. There's no depth. You could be have the most highly developed intellect without depth, just full of knowledge. So there is suddenly you discover the depth that there is to you, that you are so much deeper than any set of concepts that you have in your head about who you are. You and your past, which is of course limited, and your story, the story of you and your past. So it's the discovery of a depth, and that depth, it is fulfilling, that is so fulfilling. In that depth, what disappears is fear, because that depth is a rootedness. You sense that you have deep roots in being. Whereas in the conceptual world, you live in fear because you have no roots in being, no depths. That every conceptual entity, every little me, is extremely fearful. They might be pretending that they are not, but there's always an undercurrent of fear. So one could say that And the stronger your form identity is, the me, the stronger also the fear that's underneath it. It may be unconscious. It may be covered up by a display of confidence, but it's there. And so we are. This is also where fear goes. As a conceptual sense of self goes, you don't derive your sense of who you are from your story anymore. Then you become free of fear, because there's that depth in which you feel rooted. So you and that which you perceive suddenly acquires a depth. And that is particularly important when you relate to other human beings, because what makes human relationships so conflict-ridden and problematic is the fact that they are all conceptual relationships. Once you live in a conceptualized reality, you've constructed it for yourself, you construct that conceptualized reality for everybody that you meet. Images. And you may not have deadened that other person to the extent that a terrorist or a criminal who can kill without feeling anything, because he calls that person something in the head, reduces the person to a label or concept, and then anything is possible. You may not, it is unlikely that you would reduce a person to such a degree, but the same principle really operates in human interaction when you reduce another human being to mental concepts and opinions. So, and you can see how you then relate. If there's a depth to even a stone that you pick up and you see it through stillness, perceive it through stillness, when you relate to another human being, what depth there is, what depth you can sense through your own in the other person, even if the other person is still full of mental concepts, and even if the other person is still relating to you through his or her screen of concepts. In other words, they have a set of opinions about you and think they know you through the set of concepts and opinions. They think they know the reality of who you are. And it may be that the other person still operates through that screen. And the beauty is that when you no longer impose that screen, then it is actually possible to look through the screen that is in the other person. You see the screen, but you don't give it all that much attention. You don't take it to be the reality of who that person is. You realize it is the human condition. It is a manifestation of the human condition. This has been the human fate for many thousands of years. And you don't manufacture a personal identity for that person out of that. And then say, now I really know who he or she is. Whereas the truth is, now you really know who he or she is not. Now, the true meaning of forgiveness is not to mistake that screen, which often is energized by the pain body, which is old emotional pain accumulated over millennia in the human collective psyche because of that very dysfunction, because all that pain has continuously been created. Each human created it for themselves and for others, all the enormous inconceivable pain and suffering inflicted by humans on other humans, and they didn't know what they were doing. But that pain, because of that, and we must call it dysfunction, because of that, there is such an accumulation of emotional pain in the human psyche, the collective pain body plus the personal pain body from your lifetime. And so that amplifies very often that conceptual reality with emotion. And so your old pain flows into that madness. It's already madness. And now it becomes even more mad. So forgiveness is simply, it's not, the way people practice forgiveness doesn't really work all that well. I forgive you. And it's interesting that Jesus talks about it a lot, the forgiveness of sins, and that they say he has the power to forgive sins, and he tells his disciples, you have the power to forgive sins. What does that mean? What is sin? What is... Forgiveness is simply not mistaking that conditioning of the mind that operates for who that person is, for the realm. So if you mistake the unconsciousness, we could call it the movement of unconsciousness, unconscious conditioning, if you mistake that for the reality of that being, that person, that's non-forgiveness, the recognition that this is simply an overlay, a screen, and ultimately there is nobody there, there is no identity in it, there is no personal identity in it, the recognition of that is forgiveness. And then you don't even need the term anymore. It's the recognition of that is so simple, you don't need to say, I forgive you. There's nothing to forgive suddenly anymore. So true forgiveness happens only when suddenly you have seen so clearly through that there's nothing to forgive anymore. Forgiveness? No, what for? And that applies to yourself, because some people can't forgive themselves for something. No, it is very likely that there's far greater consciousness in you than 10 years ago. So you have moved through, you have manifested the human condition in one way or another. You had to. So it's likely that you did certain things that at your present level of consciousness you would not do, because now there's far greater presence. But when you look back, there can be a tendency for the mind to manufacture an identity for yourself out of the movement of unconsciousness, which is the human condition that you inherited. Being born into this world, you became part of that. Everybody inherits it. Now, the mind-made self, is always looking to enhance its sense of self, because it's never enough. And if it cannot find good things to enhance its sense of meanness, it will find bad things and identify with that. As long as I have an identity, I'm okay, it says. And so it will, a favorite thing is to identify with something that you did and make a personalized sense of self out of it and say, that was me. I did that. So the movement of unconsciousness becomes for you a self, an identity, and that is the egoic structures work in that way. So an essential part of many egoic little me's is that they haven't forgiven themselves, let alone others. They don't forgive others either. But they haven't forgiven themselves for something. So they derive their sense of self from the movement of unconsciousness. Totally conditioned human unconsciousness. And then, perhaps through suffering that you inflicted on yourself through that, gradually something awoke and there was an awareness that came in. Oh my God. So when the moment the awareness comes in, then you see it, and then there's the danger that you fall back into thought and immediately fall back into a false identity. Me, I did that. So it is, it's so true, the words of Jesus, the last words he said, in a normal state of consciousness, he would say, look what you did to me, you'll see what you get, whatever the mind would say, and forgive them, for they know not what they do. They are forgiven already. They know not what they do. It means they're completely unconscious. That's the modern translation. And so you might ask, so what about responsibility? Is nobody then responsible for what they do? If there's nobody there, they can't be responsible, but they will suffer. They inflict suffering on others and on themselves. They go through hell, they create hell unconsciously. And gradually, through the suffering, the awakening happens. For you, it's important to know that you do not mistake the movement of unconsciousness for somebody. That you, when you factor an identity either for yourself or for others out of that. And so the beautiful line in the Course in Miracles that I quoted the other day, whenever you meet somebody, whenever you are with another human being, that person will become a witness to you of either Christ or the ego, whatever you perceive in him or her. So you can perceive the ego and make that real, say that is who that is. Or you can look beyond that screen, and what is called Christ is simply your true nature beyond the conditioned entity, Buddha nature. Christ, your essential reality, where you are connected with the One, the Source, where you are not separate from that. And that is the depth. So the mind may try to take you out of that depth, cut you off again from it. But it's difficult now, because the it is so clear, the depth of who you are, and that there's nothing to fear there. There's only fear as long as you are trapped in a mental world of concepts. And could it begin with something as simple as picking up an object in your room, holding it and looking at it, and waiting for just the moment comes when suddenly there's just the looking, just the perception. And it happens within a field of stillness, and there's the depth suddenly there. And it's peace too. Suddenly your perceptions happen within a field of peace. They become peaceful, an alive peace, and then that becomes a new way of being in the world, non-interference to a large extent of conceptual thought. It doesn't mean you cannot use it. You're holding a pen, simply seeing it, and then somebody comes in and says, what is it that you're holding? And you, it's a pen, you say. Now you know it. You haven't lost the concept. When it's needed, it's there. When it's not needed, it's not there. Or it may occasionally still come and yet lose its heaviness because you realize there's more to it than that. So it no longer, you're no longer completely trapped in it. It's recognized as a concept. It's recognized as a thought around it. So just as you can be with an external object, you can also be with thoughts and emotions within yourself, and they are just there instead of, again, bringing in concepts into what you feel, for example, just feel. Not make a story out of that which you feel. Just be aware of what you feel. Just the feeling quality of it. And for many humans, what they feel is fear. Especially, I used to feel it especially at night, but during the day, continuously, it was in the background. But at night, waking up in a state of terror almost. And if that happens to you, it's residual fear. It's lived in there. It's part of the pain body. It's lived in there for years. To simply, just as you are with an object, be with that fear without making a story out of it. Just feel that, the feeling vibration of it, and then you allow it. Allow it. And again, even there can be a peace around it suddenly. Simply through saying, okay, there it is, and not imposing an interpretation on it. Perhaps even the word fear can go. It is just that. And then the miracle is, whatever you give your attention to in that way, which is not imposing anything on it, also undergoes a certain change. Because you cannot, your consciousness is not separate from anything that you perceive. And physicists have discovered in their experimentation in the subatomic world that the observing presence, the consciousness that conducts the experiment, influences what happens. And in many cases, it makes it happen. And in many cases, when they think there might be a particle called such and such, a little while later they discover it. And you can see how closely related the external world is and your state of consciousness, how they're one. And when you begin to interact with things around you, people around you, in this new way, perceive in this new way, changes happen in that which is being perceived in this new way. I would go so far as to say, I sensed it, but I cannot give you empirical evidence of this. Even a stone that you hold and perceive it through stillness instead of deadening it through concepts, changes happen in the molecular structure even of that stone. And it's suddenly more alive, not just to you it's suddenly more alive. Because you and it are not really separate. So you can see the incredible transformation that is here, that is not just in this little space here, how it everything gets transformed through that. You don't need to want to transform it, it happens. Your state of consciousness determines your world. This is true even in the unconscious state. If you live in a world of chaos or nightmare, inner and outer are one. Just to see that when I go into nature, and again, I cannot give you empirical evidence of this because I know it directly. I cannot tell you how I know it. When you go out into nature and you perceive nature in that way, nature fulfills itself through your perception of it. It suddenly knows itself and its own beauty and depth through you, because you're not really separate. When you look at a tree through stillness, there's suddenly, it's not just that it deepens to you, the tree deepens to itself. And so nature is so important, because we talked about yesterday that how important nature is. It can teach you stillness, yes. How you can use nature to enter that state of consciousness. It helps you, but also nature, you need nature, and nature needs you, so to speak. Ultimately, you're all one anyway. You need nature, and nature needs you. And when this transformation of consciousness happens, one could say that nature also wants that to happen, because it is important for every natural thing that you go through. This, it finds its fulfillment through that too. So when you walk through nature in that way and perceive, it rejoices because it knows itself through you. You're not separate from it. It knows its beauty and its sacredness and its depth through you. That's how important you are. And that's, you can transform the world. Not as a little me that says, I am going to transform the world. But you, now when I say you, I don't mean the you with its little history and its little, the little personal me. The depths of who you are, the consciousness that you are, the unconditioned consciousness, beyond the little conditioned entity that you are temporarily in this form, this physical and psychological form, but there is the vastness of consciousness that is the essence of who you are. That is the stillness, unformed, unmanifested, the ground of all being, out of which the whole cosmos comes every moment. So truly, you have the power to redeem the world. And could it start with such a simple thing as picking something up and just perceiving it through stillness? And you will know what I mean then when I say that Whatever you perceive in this way undergoes a change too, not just you. Every human being, that is true healing, that is not reduced to a label or a concept in your head, and is, you look at that human being through your stillness, something happens there too. No matter how unconscious that human being seems to be, how strongly that human being manifests the unconscious human collective condition. And that is true healing. Healing in its deepest sense is to be with a human being in that way of complete, spacious openness, stillness. And there, something changes, no matter how mad. And I use the word mad in the sense that that is a normal state of consciousness. But no matter how to what an extreme that human being manifests a normal mad state of consciousness, there are only degrees of madness, something happens within. If a stone becomes transformed and a tree through perceiving it in this way, you can see how a human being becomes transformed, but you are not wanting to do anything. It happens. And so one could say that you dissolve unconsciousness. It's being dissolved. To some extent it happens in this room. I am not doing anything as a little entity. How could I? But there's no thought in this head about who you are. And that is a wonderful thing. That's why I know you. Unfortunately, this is the biggest retreat I've ever had, and there are so many people. I love the personal interaction and hugging. Last time I hugged 120 people at a retreat, and that took a long time. And now we have almost 400 people here. And yet, it still works. And I know each one of you. In your essence, I know you. And that's all that's needed. When you truly know beyond concepts, beyond thought, that's the new state of consciousness. And this is why there's a field of presence here that does not just come through this form, it comes through all these forms that are losing their density, mental, emotional density, and identification with the density as me. And as the density is becoming less dense, something shines through it. And that's where the depth is suddenly there within yourself. So all these fields of consciousness, which is really what you are, a field of, it looks like a walking human being, and at the end of this retreat, you walk out of here back to where you go, but really, you're a field of consciousness, and that, like seeds moving out into different parts of the world, and then you begin to perceive and relate to the world in this new way. And you'll notice things around you change. People around you. Those who are not yet ready for change may suddenly disappear. Conditions change. Situations, conditions that you are in. you don't need any of these changes to make you feel better anymore. What's the one thing that can be quite a challenge, and that is your pain body, the accumulated pain. Although the new state of consciousness is arising, for a little while you may have to live with old accumulated pain, and that is not such a big deal once you know it, once it's no longer made into a me, a personal sense of me, my pain. It's once it no longer becomes identified with the story of me, then all you have is you're suddenly an unhappy human being, and that's who you are. That's when the pain body, the emotional vibrational frequency of that, moves into the mind and gets mixed up with the memory of your life and who you are, and an identity derived from that. Then you have an unhappy me. And when that the pain body does that, it's continuously replenishing itself through your thought processes. Through it gobbles up the energy of your thoughts, which are all negative when its thoughts are aligned with the pain body. So now there's enough presence so that the pain body is no longer able to link in to the mind and become part of your sense of self. And when then all that's left is a field of heaviness or turbulence or tightness here. Energy trapped. Fear is a contraction, it's a tightness, or sometimes a turbulence, or heaviness. It's some pain bodies are predominantly sad and or others are angry. And so now you know the pain body, you know it directly, and you watch it when it comes. It will try to trick you so that it can use your mind again, and then it becomes, again, you're back identified with human pain and becomes a me. But when you see it for what it is, you can actually perceive it, sense it in the same way that you perceive an object in your room, and just look at it, so to speak. Feel it, look at it, give it attention. There it is. But now you also sense when you watch, pick something up and perceive it through stillness, as it deepens, one could say there are two things now that you perceive. One is the object that you're perceiving. The second is you become aware of the field of stillness itself in which the perception happens. You become aware, so to speak, of awareness. This looks like duality, but that's only because of language. One could say you become self-aware. In other words, you're looking at something, perceiving this through stillness, and you see it and you feel it. So there's the perception of it. And then you sense that there's also the very power that makes the perception possible. As one could say, it's your attention. A still attention. I gave the example yesterday of ringing this bell. And again, here instead of seeing something, you're listening to it, which is another wonderful way of listening to sounds without interpreting them, without any kind of labeling. And the sound arises, and at first you're just aware of the sound, and that's fine. You give it your complete attention. Then the sound dies. What's left is the field of attention. And And then you can know that field of attention. It's not that you know the field of attention. It knows itself because you are that awareness. Even while you're listening, you're aware of the perception and the underlying field of attention or stillness. And there's no reason why you couldn't go into the middle of a noisy city. And there's all the traffic and all the thousands of people moving about. And there's the underlying field of attention. Stillness that can no longer be disturbed by anything. Once you know it in yourself as the very ground that makes all perception possible, then well, no matter where you go, it's there. As the, and I'm talking about that now because when you feel the pain body, the same thing can happen. There's not just the turbulence or the heaviness or tightness that you feel, there's also the awareness through which you can feel that, which is so much vaster than anything that could arise in it. Pain bodies look threatening at first, big monsters. And then the tendency is for you to, oh, I don't want to look at that. But when you look, and this is an old motif in fairy tales and mythology, when you face the monster, it's no longer a monster. And you know that even from nightmares, when you're running away from some dreadful thing that's pursuing you, it's dreadful. But the moment you turn around, it gets transformed and suddenly looks relatively harmless. Oh, is that all it was? And so many people never want to face the pain. So, oh, no, don't want to go there. But if they did, oh, is that all it is? It's contracted energy, heavy, tight. And it's not me. It's not. It's just a stagnated, non-flowing energy field. And it's not who I am? No. How could it be? You are the aware presence. And there's that. And so the very secret, and this is the secret, I'm telling you now the secret of life. Now, all you have to do, it's like, here's the key, but you still have to use the key. In any perception or awareness or wherever you go or wherever you are, there will be things happening, arising, internally or externally. That's the world. Things come and go. Forms, inner emotions, thoughts, outer forms, people, events, some good, some bad, whatever the mind calls it. Giving attention, yes, to whatever there is at this moment. And you cannot give full attention if you are in a at war with the present moment, then of course you can't give it your attention. So giving attention to what arises implies that you say yes to the moment and then you give it your full attention. Otherwise you can't give it your full attention. But there's more. You give attention to what arises and you are aware of that attention itself in which it arises. One could call it also an alive stillness. This is the undercurrent that is continuously there in whatever happens. So there's the event, and there's the space in which the event happens. And you stop seeking yourself in the event, whether it's external or internal, a thought, an emotion. You're not looking for yourself there, and if that's me, or identify with some external thing, it's me, personalized reactive relationship, because you're looking for yourself somewhere. I have to find myself somewhere, and it's never, you never find yourself truly, only a conceptual image, and therefore there's fear, because I haven't found myself. And so you know you're never, you're no longer seeking yourself in anything, because you already know that you are the underlying field in which it happens. The spaciousness, the stillness in which it happens. Even if it's turbulence. That means knowing yourself, non-conceptually. And that means the world is no longer a threatening place, because nothing that comes can threaten who you are. It's like saying nothing could threaten the space in this room. You can't do anything. You cannot destroy the space in this room. And it's the essence of this room. There wouldn't be a room if there were no space. The very essence of this is the spaciousness, and this is an external kind of, I'm giving you an analogy, of external space is similar to that inner spaciousness. And ultimately, what we perceive as external space is an externalization of that inner reality, the space of awareness. And it's indestructible. We could do anything. We could even make enormous amount of noise and bring in a heavy metal band to in here. The moment they leave, nothing ever happened. Just as still and spacious as it was before. And that's the true meaning again. I'm quoting again these beautiful lines at the beginning of the Course in Miracles that summarizes it all. Nothing real can be threatened. Nothing unreal exists. Herein lies the peace of God. Knowing that is the peace of God. And could it start with a simple thing, such as picking something up in your room and looking? Yes. And then beginning to live in that way. And now you'll find life will challenge you. Your new state of consciousness will not go unchallenged. You will move back into situations that are challenging, be with people that are challenging. Mind comes back at you, pain bodies come back. Now there are always two possibilities with any challenge. And any challenge says, give me your whole attention, I matter, this matters totally and absolutely, give me your attention. And then it wants it to be drawn into it. Yes, this matters. And not knowing that only one thing matters, ultimately. Everything else is relatively important, but not absolutely. It's not saying not honoring the things of this world. You're honoring, you do what you have to do. In that sense, you honor it. But ultimately, only one thing matters, and that is knowing who you are. It's not a selfish thing. It's the only true thing that you can do for the world is to know who you are, and then everything changes. Only that matters. But the world will tell you, and the world is the mind and other people's minds, this matters, come on, this is surely, you should get upset about this. Oh yes, you're right. Yeah. And even in the worst disaster, of course, it's very hard not to react when something so disastrous happens as last week, collectively. And one almost feels, I have no right to be at peace in this situation, is almost the feeling. Do I have a right to be, do we have a right even to look for peace in this situation? It's the only thing that can save humankind, peace. So it's more than the right. It's your duty is to look for peace and to find the peace. And even in such a situation where you watch the TV and, oh my God, and even there you can suddenly sense that vastness, that perhaps quite a few of the people who died a violent death, and I mentioned that at the beginning the other day, they may have also known it in the last few seconds of their lives. It often happens just before death. And we don't know that. This is not what you see on the surface. On the surface, you only see the dreadfulness of it. And then there's the vastness in which it happens. Still, always present. A form dissolves violently. The essence remains. So to even perceive disaster, whether it's your own personal disaster, which happens sooner or later because death comes, that's disastrous to the person. Big disaster. So that comes and be with it. You've died already. That means you have this false sense of identity, a conceptualized sense of self, is already dissolved. There's nothing to fear anymore. Fear is only not knowing who you are, mistaking that for who you are. There's nothing to fear. And then when death, the physical form comes, it's actually sacred and beautiful, and you recognize that. If any mind in this room says, and then what happens? And after that? Is there more then? And then you find yourself in paradise, and the mind says, I wonder if there's an even higher paradise. You don't deserve to be here, says the mind. You. So you'll be challenged by the world, by the mind, by the pain bodies in the world. And then one of two things can happen. you get drawn back into thinking that it matters and reacting as if it matters. In other words, you lose that presence. It's obscured. You can't lose it. It becomes obscured. The density returns. You become a reactive little me again. Your own pain body becomes activated again. This can happen. Challenges do that. Or the challenge through the challenge, presence intensifies in you. This happens to some people who even who've never heard or read anything about this. When they are faced with death or a serious accident is about to happen, then a moment comes when there's enormous presence. And sometimes out of that, action arises and they are saved or they save other people. And it just comes out of that state of consciousness suddenly there. It is, you can see now which way you go. The challenge can pull you back into unconsciousness or the challenge can make you more conscious. And once this, you've reached a certain level of presence is flowing through you to a certain degree, it is more likely that any challenge will intensify presence. Not inevitably, the other can also happen. In which case, you'll get drawn back, and after a while, you'll know it, and you'll step out again. And the mind will attempt to make some identity for yourself even out of that and say that you're not good enough, and you're never going to make it, or whatever it says. And then you observe that also. That's what the mind does. It wants to give you another identity. It's trying its best to give you an identity. Not good enough. Now I know who I am. I'm not good enough. Well, at least now I know. That's, So you can go both. Even if you get drawn back into reactive little me, it is not likely that you will be lost again for too long. Presence suddenly is back, and then you step out. And you will often notice, whenever it happens, of course, you lost the now. You got drawn back into time and mind and the world of problems, the heaviness of problems, not realizing that there are no problems. You believe again that there are problems. I'm saying there are no problems because there's no problem at the present moment. Challenges, yes, a challenge can happen. But it doesn't turn into a problem. It needs a problematic entity that derives its identity from a situation for a situation to become a problem. And then it's continuously revived and elaborated upon in the mind long before it ever happens, if it ever happens, probably won't, and long after something has happened, it's a problem in the mind, and there's a problematic me. And again, having problems, the little me likes that. Because the more problems I have, and this is unconscious, the more important I am. I have real problems to worry about. The little me hangs on to that too, because that also gives you an identity. You define your identity in terms of your problems. Many people do that. Unconscious, of course. Anything for an identity. So you move back into a world that is still, to a large extent, mad. Not that that is the reality of who any human being is, but that is the density that covers up the reality in human beings. And others are awakening, like yourself and others. You will meet also more people that are awakening as you awaken. And you will draw to you yourself people who are ready to awaken, and often they will come and maybe they don't know why, and suddenly they may ask a question, and then you become still and see what comes out of your mouth, if anything. So your challenge is continuing to perceive the world and to interact, knowing the field, knowing this is the true meaning of now. What is the deepest meaning of now is the field in which it happens. Nothing can happen anywhere else except now. Everything has been changing in your life. You've gone through many changes. But one thing was always the same. It was always now. Because that's the essence of who you are. Because the now is the field in which everything happens. Now is the unconditioned consciousness, out of which the whole world of the conditioned arises. Now is you. The essence of you is the now. It's a miracle. So all that there is to do, and it's not a doing, is to know the now. While things happen in it, to continue to know the now. As yourself. This afternoon, my suggestion is that as much as possible, we keep noble silence externally. The mind will do its own thing. And you can watch that. Watch that. In the now, you can still be present with that. And as that depth happens in you, more and more you may perceive the mental activity as surface patterns up here. Sometimes huge waves come and go, and sometimes little ripples. And then, yet there's a depth, so there's mind. And it doesn't matter that much anymore. The thoughts, to some extent, still come and go, although there are gaps more and more between thoughts. Yes, beautiful. Thoughts come and go, but they don't matter that much anymore. You don't believe in each thought and it draws in your attention completely. So let the mind be. So, from lunch onwards or after lunch, there may be a few silent tables at lunchtime. And then after lunch, if you can, just be in external silence and as much as you can in inner stillness. That's there anyway. Let the mind do what it wants. Perceive nature in that non-conceptual way. Be simple. And just with what is. Until you need to use speech again, maybe in the evening you may be doing something. That's fine. It may be strange if you sit at a silent table, unless you've already done quite a few retreats, in which case you're used to it. If you haven't done any retreats, at first it seems uncomfortable. There's a discomfort in you when you sit with the people and nobody is speaking. The same discomfort you might feel in an elevator. You step in, there are one or two people in it, and should I be saying something? And to simply, you can watch the discomfort, and then it goes, and then it's actually okay to just be there without feeling the need that you need to say something. Just be there. Nice practice in an elevator, too. Just be in an elevator, not here, but when you go back to the office. Any elevator, no thought. Between you press the button. And while you're waiting for it, no waiting either. And there's another little, you have little moments in your life, your everyday life. I mentioned picking up things and just looking, little moments when you're not waiting, but simply be completely, fully, totally here, in which case suddenly there's thoughtless awareness. If you're totally here, there's thoughtless awareness to being totally. Another one I often suggest to people, you get into your car, shut the door, and before you put in the key, stop. Length of time doesn't matter as long as you stop. Even if it's only 10 seconds, 30 seconds. And then you put in. Nobody can be that busy that they cannot spare 10 seconds. But the mind will tell you that you don't have 10 seconds. The stream of mind stepping out of that as much as you can. The stream of mind is the internal stream of continuous thinking. It externalizes itself as the continuous compulsion to go from one thing to the next, and you never catch up with what you have to do. It's always the next thing to do. While you're doing this, there's already the next thing to do. And this is only a means so that you can get to the next thing. And that's an externalization of the mind stream. And so stepping out of the mind stream as much as possible, as often as you can, you know now how to step out of the mind stream. And it's just alertness returns. You suddenly, there's an awareness of sense perceptions. You may feel your inner body suddenly. You may become aware that you're breathing. And most importantly, you're aware that you're aware. Don't It's more important how often you step out of the mind stream than how long you stay in that state. It's not timeless anyway. How often do you step out? And nobody is so busy that they cannot step out periodically, even while you're on a computer screen, turning around, and maybe there's a flower on your desk. And watch that. Especially important for people who are watching screens to sense the inner body so that they remain, some attention remains here, otherwise it flows out continuously. And everything is conceptual on that screen. I don't have one, but I know about it. People have told me. And a little bit, I know that these letters appear on the screen, and people think they're communicating with other human beings, but it's just little letters on a screen. So if you cannot communicate through that letter on the screen, at least you can be in touch with yourself. And then perhaps you can be in touch even with that other person, but it won't be through the letters. It's in another way, the connection will be there. We will look at questions that may arise out of the now, if they do, tomorrow. We can't know that now. Maybe no question will arise anymore. All questions may have dissolved by tomorrow. Vital questions. I would say, I'm not discouraging you from asking questions tomorrow, but vital questions, that not abstract conceptual questions, vital questions, I would say you already have the answer to yourself. If you really need to know the answer, become still. Ask the question and then let go. If you need to know it, the answer comes from within, out of the stillness, which is the vastness of intelligence itself. How could it not come? If it's not vital, the question will disappear in the stillness. You never needed to know. You just thought you did. And there's a lot that we don't need to know. Many of you know the story, I've told it quite a few times, but there may be some of you who haven't heard it. The Zen master who became famous through just one thing, he would never explain anything. Whenever people asked him, please explain to us the meaning of Zen, which of course is already an impossible question, all he would do is raise his finger and look at you. Some people got it. Of course, those who didn't get it, they ask, did you hear the question?